The Samsung HW-Q950A is Samsung's latest flagship soundbar. Its predecessor, the HW-Q950T, which I've done quite a few videos on, was very impressive, but with some slightly concerning flaws. I was hoping that the Q950A would fix some of the issues that I had with the Q950T. Some things were definitely fixed, and some things not so much, but we'll get into that a little bit later. What's up guys, Jonah Mathis here. I've been very excited about this soundbar since it was unveiled at CES 2021. Samsung was kind enough to send this review unit to me so that I could test it. I got 30 days of hands-on testing with it, and then I sent it right back to them. They aren't paying me to make this video, and I'm going to give my full and honest opinion about this system. I just wanted to be very upfront with you all about that. And if you could, take 1.2 seconds to smash the like button on this video. It would help my channel out tremendously. Let's get into the video. Boasting 11.1.4 channels of audio, the Samsung HW-Q950A officially has the most channels out of any soundbar system that's currently on the market. Quickly going over some specs, the soundbar itself is massive. 48.5 inches wide, 5.4 inches deep, and 2.7 inches tall. Not the easiest soundbar to put under a TV that isn't mounted. There's a total of 22 speakers in this entire system, 15 of which are contained within the soundbar, one subwoofer, and three speakers in each surround speaker. There's two HDMI inputs and an HDMI out / eARC port. There's also a digital optical input, but I wouldn't recommend using that because it will not send Dolby Atmos. Of course, it supports HDR10+, is Amazon ALEXA compatible, supports Bluetooth, AirPlay, and Spotify Connect for wireless audio streaming. For audio codec support, it can handle basically anything that you throw at it. Dolby True HD and DTS:X being the highest quality audio codecs that it can support. And lastly, it has two much newer features that I've never discussed before, Q-Symphony and SpaceFit Sound. Q-Symphony allows for a compatible Samsung soundbar and TV to play sound at the same exact time. This is typically something that I would never recommend for someone to do, but this technology seems to have been refined by Samsung. Unfortunately, I don't have a compatible Samsung TV, so I was not able to test this feature. And SpaceFit Sound Plus uses a compatible Samsung TV along with microphones built in both the soundbar and subwoofer to calibrate the sound to your specific room. Again, I wasn't able to test this either. Fortunately, there's another audio calibration feature built into the system that we'll discuss later. When you compare this system to the Q950T, there's actually not a big physical difference. Both the Q950A and Q950T use the same exact design for the soundbar and subwoofer. However, the major difference between the two are the Q950A's newly designed surround speakers. These surround speakers have front-firing, upward-firing, and side-firing speakers. This gives them a 2.0.1 channel configuration, while the previous versions were only a 1.0.1 channel configuration. And that's really it as far as design changes goes, which in my eyes is kind of unfortunate. Let me explain. I really like the overall design of this system. Initially, I wasn't a big fan, but it's definitely grown on me. The size and shape of the soundbar is great for larger rooms. The subwoofer doesn't look amazing, but it's not an eyesore. It's fairly compact when compared to others and is a lot more punchy than what I remember with the Q950T. And the surround speakers are very impressive. They look good and aren't too large, so it's easier for them to be inconspicuous. There are a couple of things that I really don't like about this design, and I've already mentioned these in the past too. One, personally, I'm not a fan of large cloth coverings on soundbars. I now have three cats, and over the course of 30 days, there's a large amount of hair that's accumulated on the system, and I don't want them using it as an expensive scratching post either. Two, for the life of me, I'm not sure why the display is on top of the soundbar. I understand that it kind of gets in the way of speaker drivers if it's on the front, but it's essentially useless being on the top of it. You can't see it when you're actually sitting down. It'd be different if you could control everything from the SmartThings app, but there are quite a few settings that can only be adjusted with the remote control and display and aren't available inside the SmartThings app whatsoever. Mainly the individual channel controls. You're only able to adjust these with the remote control and display, but they are not available anywhere in the SmartThings app. So if you want to adjust these, you'll have to slowly do this by standing up, walking to your soundbar to adjust the settings, then go sit back down, listen to the changes, rinse and repeat. That's very annoying. I'm really hoping that this is something that they can add to the SmartThings app in the near future. And I almost forgot. There are three LEDs on the front that indicate volume up, volume down, mute, and when the ALEXA wake word is heard. All right, after mentioning the SmartThings app many times, let's quickly discuss the setup process. This system is extremely simple to set up and use. Connect any devices you want to the soundbar's HDMI inputs. Then connect an HDMI cable from the soundbar's HDMI out or eARC port to one of the TV's HDMI inputs, preferably one that's labeled ARC or eARC. If you plan on using ARC or audio return channel to send audio from the TV to the soundbar, then you could connect your media devices to the TV's HDMI inputs instead. You could also do a combination of the both. I have a really in-depth video on HDMI ARC and eARC. If you aren't familiar with how these features work, then I definitely suggest checking that video out. Then connect the soundbar, subwoofer, and two surround speakers to power. Once the soundbar is powered on, the other components will automatically connect to it. Once you've done all this, you can actually begin using the system, but I would suggest connecting the soundbar to your Wi-Fi network first. And you do this via the SmartThings app. The app walks you through the entire setup process. I think Samsung's done a pretty good job with this app as far as functionality goes. There's definitely some issues that I have with it, but as far as setting the system up, it works flawlessly, you know, from my experience. Once the system is connected to the SmartThings app, it's a good idea to run the auto EQ process. This will automatically calibrate the system's audio for your room's size and layout. Again, if you have a compatible Samsung TV, then you can calibrate using Samsung Fit Sound Plus. If you do not, then there's another option available called Auto EQ. It uses built-in microphones on the soundbar and subwoofer to help calibrate the audio in the room. This calibration process actually failed the first time I tried it, but worked perfectly the second time. I noticed a slight difference in audio quality for the better. It's not a large difference, but a noticeably good difference. In the app, you're also able to change the soundbar's input, adjust the volume level, change the sound mode, adjust simple EQ settings, and adjust the subwoofer's level. There's also a few nifty advanced sound features available, such as voice enhancement, bass enhancement, and night mode. I think these are pretty self-explanatory. Again, in the future, I would really love for Samsung to add all of the settings that are available into the SmartThings app. This would make the display being on top of the soundbar not as big of a deal. Okay, now for what almost everyone is actually interested in. How good is the sound quality of this system? I'll start by saying this. If the soundbar wasn't completely covered in cloth, then I would have considered switching from my Sonos Arc surround system to this system. It's that good. The living room in our house is a very different shape compared to the apartment we had back when I tested the Q950T. Our living room is open on the right side when you're facing the TV and soundbar, and has a 9-foot ceiling that's completely flat. The soundbar performs phenomenally in this room, and in my much smaller studio space as well. Samsung must have improved upon the software and adjusted some settings because it sounds much better than the Q950T did, at least for me. The mid-range and highs sing and sing well. Dialogue is intelligible at basically any volume level. Typically, when I'm listening to a not so good soundbar, the main things I notice are bad dialogue levels and distortion and tinniness of the higher frequencies. I didn't get even an ounce of this when listening to the Q950-8. It does such a fantastic job of filling the space with deep and rich sound. There's not really much to complain about here. The accuracy of the 3D audio is very impressive, more impressive than basically any other system that I've listened to so far. And the soundstage is just absolutely massive. It sounds like I have a fairly decent traditional surround sound system sitting right in my living room. I think this is one of the soundbars that might actually impress some audiophiles that are out there, if they ever decide to give it a chance, but we all know they probably won't. The subwoofer was the only portion that I had mixed feelings on. For me, it seems to be there sometimes and sound really, really good, and other times, not really noticeable at all. Scenes that I know should have some pretty heavy bass just don't seem to boom like they should, and other scenes sound precisely as they should. Now, I'm not really sure if this is me being spoiled after having a Sonos Arc with two subwoofers for a while or what. Well, yeah, that's probably it, to be honest. But I do think there may be some further software adjustments that they can make. Regardless, it's much better than what I remember the Q950T sounding like. Now, regarding music. I'm not much of a music listener, more of a podcast and audiobook guy, but I do my best to give a solid opinion on music quality. Music sounds pretty good with this system, but I still think a Sonos Arc, Sub, and two 1SLs sounds much better with music. Sonos does focus on music a lot more than other soundbar manufacturers do, so this isn't very surprising to me. Again, the soundbar does a great job of producing the mid-range and higher frequencies. No tinniness, distortion, or anything like that. But you can't feel it as much as you can with other systems. The subwoofer just doesn't seem to punch as much for music as it did for movies either. But I don't know how many people are buying expensive soundbars like this with music being the main media that's in mind. Feel free to let me know if I'm wrong in the comments down below. In reality, I just wasn't super impressed with music. It sounds good, but I think it could sound a lot better with some software adjustments. Okay, now that I've talked about basically everything with this system, I want to quickly break down what I like about it and what I don't like about it. Starting out with what I like. 1. The system sounds amazing. Period. 2. The 3D audio is very accurate and convincing in the proper room conditions. Mainly a ceiling that isn't too tall and is completely flat, and a room that is semi-rectangular in shape. 3. Ease of setup. This system is so quick and easy to set up. I didn't run into any issues with this, and I haven't heard of other people having issues either. 4. The price. I'm happy to see the initial retail price at $1,600 instead of $1,800. I think $1,600 for this system is a fair and valid price tag. $1,800, not so much. If you want to pick up a pretty good system that's slightly older for a very large discount, consider the Samsung HW-Q950T. They are very cheap right now, but I would hurry because they're probably going to sell out soon. And now for what I don't like. Really, a lot of this is software related, so a lot of these things could be fixed in the future, I hope, but we'll just have to wait and see. 1. The cloth covering. I realize this may not be a big deal for a lot of people, but this is just my opinion. It doesn't look terrible, but my cats are attracted to it for some reason. 2. The subwoofer just doesn't seem to be consistent across different media. Sometimes the bass has really impressed me, and other times, not so much. 3. The display. Why is the display on the top of the soundbar? It's the absolute worst place for a display to be, except for maybe the backside of the soundbar. It's basically useless, and that goes right into my next point. You can't adjust the individual channel levels in the SmartThings app. You have to use the display for this. Why? Why can't this be in the SmartThings app? It would make it so much easier to adjust these settings. And the rest of these are really issues that I have with the SmartThings app. When you enable the bass enhancement setting, it turns the surround speakers down a lot, like a lot, and it just sounds bad. Voice enhancement isn't really great either. I would really love to see more options and more adjustability here. Instead of just an on-off switch, a sliding scale would be great. Something like the subwoofer adjustment or the basic EQ settings. I'm really hoping Samsung can do a firmware update and make some of these things just a little bit better. Okay, rant over now. All in all, I was very impressed with this system. It sounds great, it's not a bad price, and with some software updates, it can be even better. I hope all of you enjoyed this video. If you did, I would appreciate it if you click the like button if you haven't already. If you use Instagram, give me a follow at JonahMathis_YT. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye.